Welcome everyone and good afternoon. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar. My name is Chanel Moore and I'm the Peer Support Coordinator here at Lung Foundation Australia. I would like to start by acknowledging the traditional owners of country throughout Australia and their continuing connection to land, sea and community. We pay our respects to them and their cultures and to elders both past, present and emerging. Today, we're presenting a third webinar in the Understanding COVID-19 series, and this one will be focusing on support for the carer's journey. Before we open up for the discussion, there's just a few housekeeping points that I'd like to go through. The first one being that today's webinar will be recorded and made available for you to watch at a later date or share with your networks via our website, and we will notify all of you when it is made available. A Q&A session will also be held, so throughout the webinar, please do type in any questions or thoughts that you may have into the Q&A box and we'll endeavour to answer all questions. Lastly, if at any point you require urgent support or would like to reach out and connect with someone, please do so by reaching out to services such as Beyond Blue or Lifeline. And further information about those services is available on our COVID-19 web pages. Now, I have the pleasure in welcoming and introducing our speaker for today, Debra Sandford, who is a clinical and research psychologist in Adelaide. You may recognise the name. Debra has been a speaker for a previous COVID-19 webinar, the one on wellbeing, so it's great to have Debra joining us again today. Debra is a passionate advocate for ensuring the psychological health of people living with lung disease is addressed and looked after, as well as their physical health is, and she's also conducting her thesis on the psychological impact of idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis on the patient and caregiver. So thank you so much for joining us today, Debra, and sharing your insights into, you know, carer support and how, along with their loved ones, they can get through this time together. So I will now hand over to you and invite you to share your presentation and chat with everyone who's joining us today.
So welcome everybody, and thank you for tuning in, and hopefully you'll find the following webinar to hold some useful information. So I'm a clinical psychologist, and the room you can see behind me is actually my practice room, and so hopefully you'll forgive the slight clutter in the background. So, as Chanel said, the following advice is of a general nature and it's not meant to replace individual counselling, therapy or any medical or mental health advice. And if anything within this webinar does upset you or you find unsettling, please contact someone who you trust to give you advice on your individual circumstances. And there will be some resources on the final slide. So what are we going to talk about today? Well, we're going to start off with some elephants in the room. We're going to have a look at relationships, intimate family and social, carer self-care, resentment and guilt, worry about yourself and your loved ones during this time, contingency planning or emergency planning, seeking help when help is needed, marathon, not a sprint, empowering your loved one, being a parent and a carer. So we're just going to briefly touch on what it is for being a parent of a child with lung disease. And if the need is necessary, we'll make a webinar to address those issues individually. And then we'll have some links to some resources. So without further ado, we've got a fair bit to get through. So I'll start off and we'll talk about the elephant in the room. And we've got some questions that have come through from caregivers through the Lung Foundation throughout this webinar. And the first one is, I try not to speak about my worries as my partner is already sick and I don't want them to be any more anxious. And that is not an unusual question that we hear from caregivers. And the truth of the matter is that as a general rule, it actually does help to talk about these things. And, you know, talking about the elephant in the room, we don't want to, you know, our thought process is, I don't want to upset my partner by, you know, talking about things that they'll get more upset or make them feel worse. And, mostly they are feeling something similar. So the couching around the question can often create greater levels of anxiety. There are some steps that we can take to open difficult conversations, and that can be around end-of-life planning, palliative care, what do we do with the grandchildren, all sorts of difficult conversations, especially during this time. And the first step is acknowledging to your partner, to your loved one, that this conversation might be challenging and that you, one of you or both of you, might feel upset. And it's okay to feel upset because some of these things are difficult to talk about. Make a pact to take it easy. This is not a competition. It's not about who feels more upset or who has to be the bravest. It is about being on both on the same side, on the same team, and remembering that. And not necessarily stopping the conversation if one of you does become upset, because tears and distress are a normal part of, you know, talking about things that are difficult. It's okay to take a break and come back to it at a later time or date if necessary. You don't have to have these more challenging conversations in one big hit. You can tack away at it little by little, bit by little bit. And the benefits of talking openly means that you're no longer watching your words. You're no longer having to walk around that difficult subject, and it means that you're both on the same page, and you can actually, even though it is tricky, come to a far greater feeling of being comfortable about it. There are some nice books to help you. One of them that I particularly like is Talking About Death Over Dinner, and there are many other resources about how to have these difficult conversations. So moving on to relationships and the intimate relationship, and that it sort of is about having those conversations and things within that. Another question came through from another carer, and it's about my partner already has a lung infection, and I've put in their disease because they often will go hand in hand or one or the other. How do I, as a carer, stop worrying about him, and it could be her? I already have us in quarantine and he accuses me of calling the shots. Well, the calling the shots is because roles change. And many people with lung disease are older, especially if you're in the group that of people that in my study of PF, and most of them, the average age is around 60, 65. And so, you know, for many men who have got an unwell wife or an unwell female partner, they find themselves, like my fellow on the screen, having to cook dinner and do things that they haven't ever had to do. And for many women, they find themselves having to do some of the more heavy lifting jobs that they've never had to do, that their husband has traditionally done. And I spoke to about an 83-year-old woman last year, and she was up cleaning out the gutters, which is why I got that photo to take us through. So it is, the roles do change, and not only do they change with household chores and things that you need to do, but they change because you are all of a sudden become a nurse. You might be involved in medication, or if your partner is particularly unwell, you know, helping them to do their activities of daily living, like bathing and washing and toileting and things like that. So those roles change, and with them comes power imbalance often, and the patient can feel like you're calling the shots. We'll talk a little bit more about that later in the webinar, but I think the thing about being mindful that as far as possible, it's nice to maintain other aspects of the relationship as it was before your partner became unwell. Often people feel lonely within that relationship because some of the things that you would have done as a couple can no longer be done. So you might not be able to go for those walks anymore. Holidays may have become a thing of the past. And so one or both of you starts to become feeling, you know, isolated and lonely. And it's a good thing to keep an eye on that and just speak about that with people who might be able to help you come up with some suggestions about how you can be less lonely and less isolated within the relationship. I'm not going to talk much about that today because there's too many different individual circumstances where we would give more specific advice. Intimacy and staying connected. As people become more unwell, often sex and sexuality sort of goes on the back burner or ceases to exist completely. But that doesn't mean that intimacy and staying connected needs to finish. You can still be very intimate with your partner without necessarily having sex. So, you know, hand holding, having a cuddle, you know, remembering what it's like to have a good kissing session, all those things can help you stay and maintain intimacy and sensuality. Remember what you admire and respect about your partner. This is really important for every relationship, regardless of whether you are unwell or not. Often we forget that we are on the same side. And when I say talk about bids for connection, that's looking for and creating those opportunities for connection. And sometimes connection can be talked about as attention. And when we have, when we seek our partner's attention, we seek to connect with them. And so couples who are strong accept their partner's bid for connection. Couples who get into trouble often reject it. And so if you're looking out for those opportunities to accept your partner's attempts to connect with you, your relationship will become stronger. So family relationships can also be tricky in times like this, and probably, in fact, in most times, not all families, get on fabulously, and sometimes there is unfair demands made on them. And this question from another carer came through about how do we say no to your children when they ask for help and we know that we should or would be self-isolating? And that's a great question. Again, it will depend on your individual circumstances and for what sort of help they are asking for. But if it's for help to mind the children, then, you know, at this moment, we would need to probably, for many of you, you would need to think about whether or not those children or your adult children, your grandchildren, your adult children have been isolated for 14 days. So are they willing to isolate themselves in order to make sure that when they do come in contact with you, you're safe? Talking openly about your loved one's illness, many families have protected their adult children and don't want to worry them. So having open and frank conversations with the adult children, giving them information to look up regarding the particular type of illness, lung disease that your partner has or that you have, will help them to better understand any limitations that might stop you from being able to help them. Don't forget that it's not always your adult children who ask you for help. It's sometimes you need to ask them for help and or your siblings. So having that conversation where they understand some of your limitations about what you may be able to do or can't do and why you might need their assistance is a very good idea. And being prepared to, reach out and get them involved is always a good idea. We're going to talk about contingency planning, that emergency plan, a little bit more detail later, but sharing the contingency plan with your family as appropriate is an essential thing to do, especially in times like this, because then people all feel like they know what's going on. And finding alternate ways of supporting each other. So if you can't mind your grandchildren and you are financially able, maybe you can say, well, we can't mind them, but we can help you pay for a babysitter. Or they might be able to say, Mum and Dad, would you like me to, you know, deliver the groceries to your front door, or maybe I can pop out the back and mow the lawn for you, or doing other things. And of course, we support each other through contact and phone calls and FaceTime and Zoom and all those other sort of electronic ways of keeping in contact. And don't forget a good old-fashioned letter that gets delivered in the post might also be a wonderful way of cheering up an older family member. Social relationships with our friends and wider groups, many people feel disconnected with those as well. And I think many of the more organised groups like church groups and sporting clubs and things have been working overtime to make sure that they've created ways of helping their members to keep in touch with each other. But again, having open and frank discussions with your friends about the lung disease that your partner has and providing them with information is very important for them to begin to understand some of the challenges that you will be both facing at this time. Often I hear, I don't want to ask my friends for help. I don't want to burden them. I don't know the friendship is, you know, that's not that type of friendship. But when I ask most people when they've been asked for help by a friend, how do they feel about that? Most of them use the word honoured, or it was a pleasure, or I felt, you know, good to be able to help my friend rather than just pop over for a coffee. And so if you feel that way, your friends will often feel that way too. And mostly they are honoured to be asked for help and will do it willingly. People get tangled up around phone calls, and they often believe that it's like, I phoned them last time, so it's their turn to phone me now. It's not a turn-taking thing. If you want to talk to someone, phone them. Just pick up the phone and phone them. People aren't mind readers. We don't know when you need to talk. And so that's why it's important to phone them. If you feel like you are feeling the need to reach out, then phone someone and don't sit there and suffer alone. And of course, there are ultimate ways, as I spoke about earlier, to socialise. So as a carer, often carers put themselves last, and self-care is absolutely essential. It is not selfish. You need to make sure that you have time in every day to take care of yourself, because if you don't, then you won't be in any place to take care of your loved one or loved ones. So resting, find some time to sit down, read a book, knit, watch TV, have a bath, whatever it is that you do that helps you to feel rested, do it. Eating well does more than just fill your tummy up. It nourishes your soul and it provides many health benefits. For some of you, you will notice that your partner has had a change in taste buds along with their lung disease. And many of my people I've spoken to who have pulmonary fibrosis have commented that their appetite has decreased and that they no longer enjoy the food that they used to do. So cooking can sometimes be a challenge, but I would encourage you to maintain as much healthy, wholesome, fresh fruit in your diet as possible. Relaxing and resting sound similar. They can be the same, but they can also be different. Relaxing, you can be actively doing things and still feeling relaxed because they are things that keep you connected in your own interests and help you keep going. Sleep is absolutely essential for daytime functioning and good mental and physical health. If you're not getting enough sleep, please speak to your GP, someone like myself, a psychologist, about how you might be able to get better sleep, because again, that information on sleep can be quite varied depending on what it is that you're suffering, whether it's about getting to sleep or staying asleep or both. Exercise. Now, at the moment, we're all still able to get out and exercise either by ourselves or in small groups. And even just going for a walk around the block is valuable for most of us. It gets out, exercise makes our brain release, positive endorphins, and it's one of the best natural cures for depression. So doing a little bit of exercise that gets your heart pumping is absolutely fabulous. And if you can't get out and about, then maybe finding some things like our fellow in the bottom picture who's doing some arm strengthening exercises at home to help him stay physically fit is a good idea. And some of your physiotherapists and exercise physiologists can help you find exercises that are safe for you and your partner to do. Hobbies are essential. They help you relax and feel good and connected. So whatever it is that your hobby is, don't forget to find some time to do that. And make sure you find time for your own health. You know, don't put yourself last. Get your flu jabs, get your checkups, attend to your appointments. And that can include, you know, going and getting your hair done, because most women know that when they have had their hair done, they feel better. So on to other things that get in the way of being and feeling good as a caregiver. And these are two things that people often find difficult to talk about, and that is resentment and guilt. They're actually really normal reactions. They're normal reactions because life has changed. So for many caregivers at the moment, life has changed in so many ways. Not only has your role changed, you've gone from being a wife or a husband or a partner or whatever the relationship that you have to a caregiver, but also through the COVID-19 restrictions, everyone's life has changed. And so some of the things that you may have done that gave you the capacity to, you know, keep going and have strength has been restricted for a time. So, you know, resentment comes because your life has changed. It's not what you imagined your life was going to be like. No one ever gets married and thinks, oh yes, I'm going to end up caring for someone who's unwell. You might miss how it used to be, and that's perfectly normal. And sometimes the person we're caring for feels ungrateful, and often that grumpiness, that ingratitude comes because they too are feeling resentment, guilt, stress, frustration, and all of those things can sometimes come out, and we often make the person we love the most pay the bill. Guilt, when we feel resentful, we often, our following thought from that is, oh, I shouldn't be thinking this way. I'm just, you know, that's awful. I must be such a bad person for feeling this way. So, you know, that guilt feeling is, again, a very natural feeling. But guilt and shame are two of the most soul-destroying emotions that we have, and are rarely, rarely useful. So when you notice that you're feeling guilty, try not to. It's just a thought. Just because you think it doesn't necessarily make it true, and it's not your sole delineator of who you are. These thoughts come and go, a bit like clouds running across the sky. You know, we all have these thoughts. Some people, you know, have awful dark thoughts, but they're the nicest people. That's just what brains do. And as I said, often your partner, the person who has a lung disease, is feeling resentful and a bit guilty because they can't do what they used to do with you. They may have been the breadwinner and now they're not. They may have promised to take you on a world tour and now you can't do that. So all of these things impact on them as well. And often if you're both feeling those things at a similar time, you're going to rub up against each other. So we had a question as well, and I think I've put that about on one of the other slides. We worry about ourselves and our loved one. So as I said at the last slide, worry and frustration can often look a lot like anger. And when we notice that we're coming across in a negative way, sometimes if we can, it's nice to just take a breath, take a step back. Be gentle with yourself. Telling yourself off never, ever changes anything. When we're kind and gentle to ourselves, we're more likely to be able to change our behaviour. Be a bit kind and curious about what's behind that negative emotion. And if it's worry, can we change it to worry rather than anger? A common thought is, what will happen if I get sick? And that's in normal times as well as in COVID-19 times. And that's where it's really important to have those conversations and make what we call a contingency plan or an emergency plan. And so making these plans doesn't mean that you're going to have to use them. But if they do have to be used, it saves everybody running around with one foot nailed to the floor in ever in decreasing circles, feeling quite panicked. So a good contingency plan has your loved one who has lung disease, their full name, all of their contact details, and another contact as well in it. Who to contact in an emergency. That might be a sibling, it might be an adult child, or it could be a trusted neighbour or friend. Any medication that your loved one is taking and the times and quantities that they need to take. Any ongoing treatment they're having, so if they're having chemo or radiotherapy or they have physiotherapy or whatever it is that they're having, any details of that treatment, any allergies they have, that's really important. So we also need to talk about who their GP is, who their respiratory specialist is, and who their regular pharmacist is. And any outside support agencies and persons. Now, not all of this information is going to be relevant for all of you. Some of this is only for people who are very, very unwell and may not be able to speak for themselves or talk to themselves, and others are still very able to give this information. But if it's written down, then it means that we don't have to go searching for it. Other things that we'll want to put in the contingency plan are any mobility challenges and aids that your loved one might need or use. If incontinence is an issue, then you might need to detail what continence products are needed. Behavioural cognitive issues, sometimes of course we have a cognitive issue that comes in with physical health. So any of those things and any other information that would be helpful to make sure that your loved one has as good of continuation of care as possible. The other things that are really important, and some people put off because getting these things made makes them talk about things that are challenging, and we come back to that elephant in the room conversation, and they are enduring power of attorneys, wills, and of course advanced care directives. Now your respiratory physician, your GP, and the respiratory nurses at the hospital can help you develop an advanced care directive, and of course a lawyer can help you draw up an enduring power of attorney and a will. So it's always advisable to have those in a place and let people who you've shared your contingency plan with know where they are kept. So other contingencies that we would need to think about, of course, are shopping, because it's not safe for many people with lung disease to be out and about at this particular time. And that's where we might rely on neighbours, family, friends, church, social groups, people who can get out and about and get them to do your shopping for you and drop it off at the front door. Initially, when the C19 restrictions came in, many of the supermarkets stopped home delivery. I believe most of them have got it back online again now. So that's also another option. Minimising having to go out is always a really good idea. And many other shops will actually meet you at the door and put it in your boot. Things like hardware shops, takeaway shops, are more than willing to accommodate needs. And coming back to whether yourself gets unwell or your partner gets unwell, preparing a hospital bed for both of you with the contingency plan and other information within it is also a good idea. And hopefully if it's prepared, you'll never have to use it. So this is something that we've heard a lot of from the respiratory patients that I've been dealing with a lot, where they're actually scared to go to hospital or go to their doctor because they don't want to come in contact with COVID-19, and they believe that it would be more that would, when they go to hospital or their doctor, that's more likely for them to be doing it. If you are unwell, the current information from our respiratory physicians is to seek help. Do not wait. They are very concerned that the collateral damage of people not seeking help when they need it is that some people will become more unwell where they should have actually had an admission to hospital or something. They are all the Australian hospitals that are preparing for having COVID-19 patients have separate areas for COVID-19 patients are from normal admission patients. And the pictures that I've got there, that fellow with his stethoscope around his head is my darling husband. That's Professor Paul Reynolds, and he's a respiratory physician at the Royal Adelaide Hospital in Adelaide, Australia. The chest x-ray you see is actually an x-ray of a COVID-19 patient, and you can see that their lungs are quite cloudy and not looking particularly healthy. And of course, the bottom photo is of one of our fabulous respiratory nurses offering some care and support to a patient who's on oxygen. So being a caregiver is a marathon, it's not a sprint. And another question that came through from a caregiver is all about feeling overwhelmed at times and worried about someone else, you know, worrying that what will happen if something happens to me and how do I go on about my day-to-day life whilst being worried. And if this was someone who came in to see me, I would talk to them about the fact that life is dialectical, and that pretty much means in psychology terms that two opposing truths can be true and exist at the same time. And so when we do a therapy called dialectical behavioral therapy, that's what we get people to really know and understand. So I can be worried about my loved one, I can still enjoy this activity over here. They can both happen and exist right at the same time. And it happens anyway, but we struggle with the fact that our brain wants us to have one or the other, and that we find it difficult to let them sit together and not fight them. And, you know, it is important if you are going to be a caregiver that you do find ways to go about your day-to-day activities and enjoy life, because caregiving can often be a very long proposition. Like I've said here, it's a bit like marriage. Mostly it's for a long-term proposition. And it's really important to start off your caregiving journey how you'd like to continue. And if you would like to continue to be vibrant and engaged and enjoying life as much as possible while still giving care to someone you love, then it really is important to learn what services are available that might be able to help you. And they will differ from state to state and region to region. And talk to your team. And it's really important to create that team around you. And that will consist of, at minimum, your GP, the respiratory specialist, palliative care specialists, nurses, physios, me, psychology. So many people talk about the fact that they had physical support when they first were diagnosed with their lung disease, but they were left floundering a little bit when it came to rationalising it as their lung disease emotionally and psychologically. So don't be afraid to ask your GP for a referral to see someone like myself. And we're very good at being able to help with that psychological burden of being a caregiver and feeling sometimes a little bit lost. So being a caregiver is about caring and about helping and about doing things for your loved one as their lung disease makes them less able to do things for themselves. But that is a real balancing act. It is so hard to sometimes get the balance right, because once you start caring and that role change takes over and you start, you know, calling the shots, as an earlier slide and question talked about, you can find that you just naturally do more and more and more and more for your loved one who is unwell. As much as possible, don't. Try and let them do as much as they still can for themselves, because that will, if they can recover, it will help them recover faster. If it is a non-recovery type lung disease, it will, but making them doing things for them too much will increase feelings of helplessness and hopelessness and actually make them get more unwell quicker. And physical health and mental health don't happen in separate vacuums. They happen together, and one does impact the other. And we know from COVID-19 that the second part of the disease often will create what we call a cytokine storm or an inflammatory marker storm within the body, which is why we have lung exacerbations. But those same inflammatory markers impact our capacity for good mental health. So we know that physical health and mental health go hand in hand. If your loved one is in pain, and not all lung diseases have pain, but if there is a pain involvement, research shows that if we ask our loved ones about their pain too much, it actually increases their, it brings their attention to the pain and actually can raise their level of pain on a pain score. So what we tend to advise you to do is agree that they're in pain and that they will let you know if it changes significantly. And that action actually helps often their pain score to go down, and they can find themselves being able to attend to other activities that help them feel better about themselves and their situation. So others don't get it. No, others don't get it. And there's on the media, if you watch the news, there's demonstrations all over the place in the world where people are ignoring the recommendations and not adhering to social distancing and all sorts of things. And the question from a caregiver came through about other people don't get it and understand how serious COVID-19 is, which is so hard when we're adhering to social distancing rules and they're not. How do we negotiate that? Well, that's tricky. And my first question would be, is it friends or is it strangers? So if it's friends, talk to them. Have that frank talk with them and give them information and try and help them understand. And if they don't, then put a wall up and for the moment, don't see them. If it's strangers, pick who you're going to spend or waste your time on. Some people are just perpetually ignorant. And like I've said, they have to be avoided at all costs because they are leeches on your soul. They are not going to make you feel better. And they will probably yell abuse at you because you dared to ask them to step back and stand back. And in fact, I was in a supermarket not so long ago and someone was right at my shoulder and I said, would you mind stepping back a little bit? And the woman was less than pleasant, shall I say. So others don't get it. It brings out the best in human nature and the worst in human nature in times like this. I would like to think that most people are, it's bringing out the best. There's some fabulous kindness things going on and stuff, but if people aren't getting it, avoid them at all costs because they're not good people to be around. So lastly, before we hand over to questions, we are going to talk about what it's like to be a parent and a caregiver. And I've only got two slides for this, but as a parent and a carer, it's really important that you understand that you shouldn't be trying to do this all alone. Call in your village. It takes a village to raise a child, and it certainly takes a village to help look after a child that has illness as a major part of their life. When you attend appointments, before you go, make your list of questions so you remember what you need to ask and get information on. If you're able to email them to the doctor in advance, that would often be helpful because then the doctor or the nurses that assist them can get that information for you and might even be able to email it back so you've got it written down. If your child has to undergo medical procedures, the advice from all of the hospitals and all of the research suggests that we do it in simple and accurate language. If they have to have a procedure that could potentially be painful, like an injection or some sort of surgery, let them know that it might hurt. It's going to hurt. You know, it will hurt for a little while, but what we're going to do is don't forget to get support for yourself if you need it. And some of the warning signs that you may need extra support are listed below, and that's about feeling exhausted, changes in sleeping and eating patterns, not really wanting to go to any social activities and just preferring to be at home because you just can't be bothered. Heightened emotions or a significant decrease in emotions are all cues that you're probably needing some extra support, and that would be a good time to find someone like myself. And try and practice some of those healthy coping strategies, you know, getting exercise, making sure you've got time to catch up with friends, and don't be afraid to ask for help if you need it. If your child has to go to hospital, that can be a scary procedure or for both of you. And there's a few things that you can do to help make that a little bit easier. So packing a favourite toy or a blanket or both. Regardless of how scruffy it is, it doesn't matter. If it's their favourite toy, pack it. If your child is young, or even if they're not young, but many young children have special names for things that they do, so write it on the whiteboard behind their bed or tell the staff what the special names are so your child doesn't feel like they can't, you know, that they're not understood. Try and be there as much as possible or have a trusted adult there with them, because it can be a really scary time for and place to be in hospital when you're little and all alone. If you have to leave for some reason, let them know when you'll be back. So I'm just going downstairs for a coffee, or I've got to go to a meeting. I'll be back in an hour, or I'll be back by nighttime, or I'll be, you know, so let them know. Try and get them as involved in their own procedures as they can be, as is feasible for their age, and explain what's going to happen, or get the staff to if you don't feel able to do that. Lots and lots of reassurance, lots and lots of cuddles, playing games, just sitting with, reading stories, all sorts of things. And staying connected with family and friends and pets and stuff via FaceTime and phone calls is always a good thing if your child is needing to be in hospital. And my last page is a few links to some resources and some things that might be helpful. Each state seems to have a carer support network, and the web address seems to be carers and then New South Wales or Queensland or South Australia or victoria.com.au or .org.au. A simple Google search will help you find that. There's a fabulous little app that's just been released. It's called Mindset. At the moment, it's only available for Apple, and they're trialing it on Android. That the little red and white symbol next to this on my webpage is the logo. It's actually hypnosis apps, and they have everything from sleep to anxiety to feeling calm and all sorts of things. It's free for the month of April, and I believe after that it might have a small cost associated with it. But some of the best clinical hypnotherapists in the world have contributed content to that app, and many of my patients have found it very, very useful, especially the sleep apps. Of course, the Lung Foundation of Australia is always there to help, and at the end of the phone, so don't be afraid to give them a call for advice or resources on their webpage. The Australian Psychological Association has a Find a Psychologist link, and that's it, as does the Australian Clinical Psychologist Association. And the last one is me, Quality of Life Psychology. We're in South Australia, but we can offer telehealth. And you might have other psychologists in your area that you've already connected with or whatever. Please don't be afraid to reach out to us. You can get up to 10 sessions through a mental health care plan that your GP can write a referral for. And Medicare will either cover the whole of that if your psychologist is prepared to bulk bill you, or there might be a small gap fee. So please don't struggle through this alone. Reach out. There are many people out there who would like to make your journey as easy as possible. And with that, I'll say thank you so much for listening to me, and I hope some of this information has been helpful. And I think we're going to open it up to questions now.
Great. Thank you so much for that, Debra. It was really helpful to hear some of your insights, and, you know, particularly around the self-care and, you know, remembering that when people reach out to us for support, we do so, and how that can be quite an honour, and to ask other people for help when you need it. So Thank you very much. I hope that everyone found some value in those words and those insights. And we are now at the Q&A section of the webinar. So please do submit any questions that you may have via the Q&A box. And just to note that they will be of a general nature, but we really do encourage you to share what's on your mind at this stage. So we'll just give everyone a few moments to get some questions coming in, and then we will get going and put those to Debra. Okay, so it looks like we have a question, Debra, just around, engaging in challenging conversations. So if you're able to expand or provide some more insight into how to initiate some of the difficult conversations that you might need to have with a loved one as a carer.
So again, that I'd like to say it's easy and there's one simple way of doing it, but there's not, because not everyone has a storybook, fairy tale relationship, and some relationships are tricky. And I think for people who have a slightly tricky relationship, then it's always a wise idea to get individual advice. But as a general rule, it's a good idea to have those difficult conversations where I would almost treat it like a meeting. I'd make an agenda. I'd think about what it is that I need to discuss so you can stay on task. Because often difficult conversations will start here, but then they'll go down a rabbit hole and they'll end up with old injuries and things that haven't actually been resolved in the past. And it's a good idea to try and stick to the topic. Do it when you're both in a good place, in a calm, receptive mood. Sit down at the table with a cup of tea, or maybe, somewhere in the lounge room. So not doing it when you're upset and agitated. Acknowledging, as I said in the slide, about having acknowledging that this is a difficult conversation, but it's one that needs to be had, and taking that break if you need to, if you both get distressed. But don't take that distress as something about we can't talk about this is too upsetting. It's just like, okay, we just need to take this in smaller pieces and come back to it when we're feeling able to do it again.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Debra. And we have another one already. How does someone emotionally support their wife or partner when it all gets a bit too much and they break down?
So sitting with someone who's crying is one of the trickiest things that psychologists have to learn. When we first start learning how to be a psychologist, when someone cries, we immediately want to stop them crying, because crying makes us feel distressed. And understanding that about ourselves, and understanding that expression of emotion with tears or distress, even if it's not teary, is okay. It's actually a good thing. It's a bit like the steam release valve on a pressure cooker. Tears help release some of that pressure, and sitting with someone, just maybe sitting beside them, if they're a touchy person and will be comforted by a hug or a hand on their hand or a squeeze on their shoulder, then maybe some physical contact, if appropriate, would be okay. But just sitting there and saying, what you're feeling is normal and natural and okay. I get that you're upset, and I'm here for you, and pass them a tissue, and then tears will eventually stop. Everyone can stop crying eventually, and then give them a hug and saying, and then when they're ready, move on. The worst thing we can do is say, don't cry, don't cry, don't cry, or okay, there, stop. We just let them cry.
Thank you, Debra. That's really beautiful advice about allowing someone to cry and to express themselves. And, I guess following on from that kind of question, we do have one from a carer who's been caring for their husband for a long time, but feels that there's not a lot of support within the family, and it's a bit of a taboo to talk about their feelings as a carer. And, you know, that can be extremely hard. Do you have any suggestions, particularly if this person's previous support networks have passed on?
I suspect, when there's not a lot of support from the wider family group, that probably is looking at an underlying family dynamic that might be a bit tricky. And when people have been sick for a long time, people become exhausted. When something bad happens, immediately people race in to offer help and support, but then over a period of time that help fades away as they sort of say, "Oh, aren't you better yet? Or you still got that?" Or, and life just takes over. And we see that even with natural disasters like bushfire and things like that. Initially lots of people race into support and then it fades from our awareness and life goes on. So being prepared to continually or frequently remind them that you do need assistance and be quite specific on what help you would like. Many people say, "I need help," but that's where that stops, and it's up to the person they're talking to actually understand exactly what help does that look like. Do you want me to mow your lawn? Do you want me to cook you dinner? Do you want me to take them to an appointment? Do you want me to come and help you do some housework? Do you want me just to sit with you and give you company? What do you want me to do? And if we can be quite specific in that help and what we're asking for, that gives the person that we're asking a very clear idea whether they have the capacity to do it or whether they can't. And we shouldn't forget that there are non-government and government organisations out there that actually have their sole purpose is to provide in-home help and maybe get an ACAT assessment where we can get cleaners in or gardeners in or people to come in and give respite. The federal government has 63 days, I think it is, a year for carers and also for the patient to have respite care. And so, being aware of what is available in your area for you is also really important. But be specific on the help you need.
Okay, great. Thank you. I hope that was helpful for the person who asked the question. We have another one, and that's around this time, support for each other. So what is the best way to help other carers cope? So do you have any insights into supporting each other and other carers?
So just let me clarify that. You mean a carer supporting another carer?
Yes, I believe that's what the question is getting at, yeah.
Two carers are co-carers, or three carers are three carers, and each of their journeys, each of their experiences are going to be different. It's like going to a mother's group when you've got a new baby. Every baby is different. Some has reflux, some sleeps well, some eats well, some has bottle fed, some are breastfed. And trying to compare a newborn baby with another newborn baby, you're going to find that your experiences are different, but then there are always some commonalities. And so when you're supporting each other, be aware that their journey, their challenges might be different than yours, because their person that they're caring for might be at a different stage of lung disease or physical, unwellness, whatever, because not everyone's caring for someone with lung disease. It's about being open and hearing. And what we would do is active listening. So let that person talk about their experience without saying, "Oh yeah, I know what you mean," when that happens with mine, because sometimes that invalidates someone when we're trying to validate them, but what we're actually doing is invalidating them. We're not hearing them. So just saying, "Okay, so what you've said is you find it really tricky when blah, 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 blah." So repeat back what you've heard to your friend or your other carer. And then when it's your turn, you get to talk, and that's when they do active listening back to you.
Okay, great. Thank you for answering that question, Debra. And look, we just have time for one more question. So we have had some questions come through around, what a carer can do if their loved one is struggling and their own quality of life has lowered, or if they're having thoughts around, negative thoughts around their quality of life and self-harming thoughts. So any advice that you have around coping with that if you're a carer?
So thoughts of ending your own life or wanting to have a euthanasia option are very, very common amongst people who have been diagnosed with a terminal illness. And that is part of one of those tricky conversations. That's part of that sort of advanced care planning. I would, again, there's a myth around talking around suicide and euthanasia, where if we actually mention the S word, suicide, or self-harm, then we are going to encourage that person to do it. And again, the research does not support that. The research supports that if we can talk with that person about their feelings, then they will feel more supported and will actually be less likely to do it. Now, if someone is what we would call actively suicidal, there's differences between having fleeting suicidal ideation. Often that's an indication that the person is feeling overwhelmed, hopeless, helpless, and they may need some psychological or some psychiatry intervention, where we do have some medication that can help people not feel quite so, down. And I would always encourage those caregivers and the people with lung disease to seek help, because you don't have to go through this alone. So if it's just fleeting, we might be able to look at it in that way. If it is active and we are starting to, people are making a plan and they are saying goodbye and all of those things, then we probably need to call in the troops and step up the intervention to help them be better. Now, Victoria have euthanasia laws now where people can choose to have that, but the rest of Australia at the moment doesn't. And I would encourage anybody who has lung disease or is a carer of someone with lung disease to talk to their respiratory physicians about palliative care. Palliative care is not the last 6 weeks of life. Palliative care should be a discussion that you have with your respiratory physician or your GP at the beginning of your lung disease journey, because all of the research shows that good palliative care, that's about pain management and quality of life management, will actually help you maintain a higher quality of life through to the end. And there are such individual circumstances that I would be more than happy to talk to people individually about that. But I hope that more general talk about not being afraid to talk about those hard subjects is absolutely essential.
Thank you, Debra, for addressing that. And, thank you for everyone for being so open and sharing your questions. It's always helpful to see what other people are going through, and I'm sure that some of the questions that came through, many people have, been thinking about similar thoughts. So really appreciate everyone joining us virtually today and sharing some of their thoughts. And thank you very much to Debra for joining us again today and addressing such an important topic. So we are now at the conclusion of the webinar. I just wanted to remind you all that we do have a lot of information and resources on our website around COVID-19, and our information and support centre is open, so from 8 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. So if you do want to ring up and find out about resources or information or referral pathways, to please give us a call and we can have a chat with you about those. So before I go, I just thought I would check, Debra, if there's anything else that you would like to add before we end.
No, nothing really, but just bearing in mind that some of the things we have talked about are of a sensitive nature. And so if anybody is feeling distressed, Lifeline, Beyond Blue have some 24-hour work helplines, you know, where there's always someone available to talk to. Just to be kind and gentle to yourselves in these tricky times. And thank you for listening.
That's great. Thank you, Deb, for that reminder about those services. And as you said, yes, be kind to yourself, everyone. And thank you for coming on and joining us today. So take care of each other and goodbye for now.